Good morning, Calvary. Welcome this morning. I'm Pastor John. I'm the lead pastor here at Calvary. If you're new, we want to welcome you. If you're watching out there around the world somewhere through our live streaming opportunities, we want to welcome you to joining us today as we focus in today on who Jesus is and as we discover that faith produces obedience. We have the privilege of having the Moody Chorale with us today from Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. Before we begin, just two brief recommendations for you. In the connector that you received when you came in, there is an offering envelope for the Moody Chorale. In addition to your regular giving to the Lord's work here at Calvary and around the world, please put something extra in here for the Moody Chorale to help cover the expenses that they have in making this great trip to be here with us today. And then also, thank you from the pastoral staff of Calvary for the wonderful Christmas gifts that you gave to us this year. Just want to say a word of thank you on behalf of Pastor Drew and Pastor James Allen, Pastor Josh, and myself. Thank you. In Psalm 95, we see an interesting comparison between singing worship and prayer. And it says this, "O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise." Then in verse 6, "O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker." Our Father, we come to you today as a congregation with a different environment today, that we will be bowing down in our hearts before you as others sing. And yet even in their hearts as they sing, they are bowed down before you. And that as we sing, we actually pray. And we thank you for that privilege of worship today. Amen.
A song is a beauty. Good morning. My name is Eric Reyes, and I have the joy of serving as the Chorale's president this year. It's our joy to be here with you today in Eau Claire. We've enjoyed so far this ministry tour that we've been partaking on. The Chorale's goal and desire is to worship the Lord and to proclaim His name. And so we do that through the singing of songs, we do that through the recitation of scripture, and we do that through personal testimony. And as the lyrics to the song that we just sang so beautifully stated, we do it that men may come to know and adore Thee. And so, Lord, this prayer we bring, and Lord, it's to You that we sing. And so the majority of this morning as we worship together will be us singing, but we would love for you to join us as well congregationally. For it is truly together that we in tandem are bringing praises to our God who is so more than worthy. This year the chorale has a theme verse, and it comes from James 1:12 that says, "Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having withstood the test, he will receive the gift and the crown of life promised to those who love him."
So I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge. My shield, the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies.
There we go. Oh, wow. Let me say that one more time. The lyrics to that piece come from the Psalms. It says, Lord, open my mouth and my lips will declare your praise. And that is our desire this morning. There's a part in our concerts that one of us gets to come and share part of our testimony with you. And today, I have that privilege of being able to share with you all this morning of the story that God has done in my life. But before I begin, I want to make it very clear that I'm actually not the main character in my story. The main character is Jesus. And my story is all about how he rescued me because of his marvelous and wonderful grace from a life that was headed towards destruction. Psalm 32 says this, Blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord does not count against him, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. But then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. I grew up in a Christian family. My dad is a pastor. And so growing up, I was always in the church. Whenever the doors were open, we were at the church. And so I grew up hearing about Jesus. And I accepted Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior when I was about 5 years old. But I can honestly say that I didn't know what it meant to be a follower of Jesus until about fifth or sixth grade. During that time, up until then, I had been living a very a life centered on people pleasing. I was always getting in trouble at school, and I lived a very secretive life. My parents didn't know the fullest extent of who I was. Who I was at home was very different than who I was in the classroom at school. And I had no purpose other than people pleasing. And because of that, I was not in pursuit of a relationship with the Lord. And it wasn't a priority for me. But I remember the summer after my fifth grade year. I don't even know how it really began, but the Lord, in his great mercy, began to show me little by little, and then all at once, my need for him. And it was like he brought to mind all of the things that I had done throughout that year, at school in particular. And it was like he was displaying it for me to see and saying, David, you need me so bad. And it was really hard for me to come to grips with that I was on the path to destruction. And it was hard for me to see that I had disappointed my family, I had disappointed the Lord. But more than that, I had to come to grips with I was not trusting alone in the saving blood of Jesus Christ on my life. And it was through that time that the Lord drew me to himself and showed me my need for him. And I can honestly say that the Lord cannot use anybody until he breaks them first. And it was through that process that the Lord really did break me. And it hurt. It really did. But it's the best thing that's ever happened to me. And I can honestly say that Jesus is the Lord of my life, and I've given my life to serving him. And you might be here this morning, and you may have heard this message before. You've heard the message of the gospel, and you know what it is to walk with Jesus each day of your life, and how sweet a thing that is. But you may be here this morning and you've heard the message, but you haven't accepted that Jesus Christ came and he lived and he died for you. Maybe you've never even heard of Jesus before. And I want to explain this to you in the best way that I know how. You see, God made you and he made me to be friends forever. But you see, you and I have done wrong things in our lives. We've lied, we've cheated, we've had sinful thoughts, and we've turned our backs on God. Now you see, the Bible tells us that God is so holy and he is so perfect that he can't stand that sin in our lives. And so because of that, he has to turn his back on us. It gets worse than that, though. Because God is so holy and so perfect, he has to punish us so that we're far from God forever. But you see, you would think that God would be okay with that. After all, we're the ones that chose treason. We're the ones that chose to turn our backs on him first. And you'd think God would be okay with leaving us in that state. But that's not who God is. You see, God loves us so much that he sent his one and only son, Jesus, to take our punishment for us when he died on the cross. And because of that, and only because of that, if we turn back to him and recognize, God, I'm a sinner. I know that. I recognize that I need saving and that I can't do it on my own. I know that when Jesus came and lived a perfect life and died on the cross, he did that in my place. I deserved that. When we tell that to God and when we truly believe it, God does the rest. He picks us up. He wipes our hearts clean and he restores that relationship that we were meant to have all along. But it's not just friends forever, it's family forever. It's union with Christ. And that's why we sing. That's the message we have. Music is empty without Jesus in it. And so that's why we sing. And if you don't know what it is to have life in Jesus Christ, that's our prayer for you this morning, is that you wouldn't leave here without knowing him on the personal level. Don't just know about him, know him. We're so thankful to be here. We're going to sing another piece. It's an old hymn called, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go. And the first stanza says, O love that will not let me go, I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths its flow may richer, fuller be. Our prayer is that you would know that love of Christ this morning.
Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall troubles, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
From my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in my day of disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place, and he rescued me because he delighted in me.
Will not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths its flow may richer
night that fall west all my way. I yield my flickering torch to thee. My heart restores its borrowed ray, that in thy sunshine's day its play may brighter
say again how incredibly blessed we are to be here. My name is Georgette, this is my friend Brennan, and we're just going to spend a little time telling you about Moody Bible Institute, where we come from. Moody Bible Institute opened its doors in 1886, over 128 years ago, as a legacy of Dwight Lyman Moody. D.L. Moody had a vision for a school in the heart of Chicago, which would prepare men and women for Christian ministry. Moody Bible Institute is characterized by a commitment to the lordship of Jesus Christ, the authority of our God's word, and the cause of world evangelism. Moody reaches lives through undergraduate, seminary, and distance learning education opportunities, as well as Moody Radio and Moody Publishers. You can find out anything you want to know about these ministries at our website, moody.edu, but we would like to highlight a few of these ministries now.
Moody Radio began in the 1920s and now owns and operates about 36 radio stations across North America. Even if you live outside of the coverage network area, we are online as well at moodyradio.org. You can listen to online on one of its six radio stations that they offer there. Now, Moody Publishers, on the other hand, they began in the late 1800s and has since published hundreds of books about applying the Word of God to life. If you are interested, we have some of those titles with us.
Now, the primary ministry of Moody Bible Institute is education, and everyone you see up here is a student at the Chicago undergraduate campus. We offer fully accredited degrees that are designed to prepare people for vocational ministry with a core curriculum in Bible and theology. undergraduate students at the Chicago campus receive a tuition-paid education, which is an incredible blessing as a lot of us are going into ministry. And it helps us to enter that ministry without worrying about having to pay back debt or loans. There is also an undergraduate campus in Spokane, Washington, excellent distance learning and online education opportunities, and graduate degrees are available through the Moody Theological Seminary as well. Moody also does a series of conferences. We have men and women's conferences, marriage conferences, pastors' conference, and one coming up in February. The first week of February is Founders Week, in which we celebrate D.L. Moody's birthday with speakers, music, and worship.
Do we have any chance, do we have Moody alumni here in the audience today? Any raise any hands? Oh, I see a few right here.
Oh, some over there.
Cool. Yeah, well, we love getting plugged in with you guys, and we just see more ways. Moody loves to keep in contact with their alumni, so please feel free to visit us at the back table after the conference, or after the concert service, rather. That would be more appropriate. Moody, as you can tell, has many biblical resources to help you apply the Word to life. One that we are really excited about right now is Today in the Word, Moody's daily devotional. It's designed to help you grow spiritually through daily biblical readings. You can sign up to receive our free email daily at our website, or we have physical copies as well. You might be thinking, I wish that I could hear this Moody choir all the time. Well, you possibly could. We have CDs in the back. So please feel free to see. I will be there as well as a few of my great, wonderful friends in this beautiful concert. So yeah, please come see us. If you have any more questions, again, please come see us. Thank you so much for allowing us to be in your church and allowing us to worship with you today.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation, which is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you did not see him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'm going to box myself in so I don't wander, and that way I stay focused. Are you blessed? Anybody want to go back to college? I'll probably be there for the pastor's conference this year again, but you guys will probably all be gone by then, so won't get to see you, but appreciate the ministry. Just as a word of information for you guys, 1925 through 1928, my grandfather, Dr. J. A. Van Gorkum, was a professor in biblical studies at Moody. So it's pretty cool. I got a picture of him with all the faculty in my office in one of the yearbooks from, or historical books from back then. So I have a real heart connection to Moody. Thank you for being here. And thank you for the theme that you bring to us today about the relationship between faith and love and trials. And for even your theme verse that we preached on 2 weeks ago, as we have started a series going through the book of James called Faith in Action. And so just as a refresher for you, in our first two messages, we dealt with how faith responds to those trials. Faith endures trials joyfully, and then faith escapes temptation. Today we move into the next passage in James chapter 1, starting in verse 19. By the way, I forgot to do this. If you have children that would like to go to DiscoverLink, you can take them out right now, even though we didn't put an official screen up, if you haven't done that already. And if you need a Bible because you didn't bring one today, we have men at the back who are prepared to bring you one if you'll put your hand up. And if you want to keep that Bible because you don't have one for your own, it's our gift to you. Please take it with you. But if you have a need for a Bible, put your hand up and someone will bring one to you. And you can open that Bible to page 1011, page 1011. And for the rest of you that have other Bibles than the ones we give out here, you can turn to the book of James, which is near the back of the New Testament, the book of James. And the issue that James is going to deal with today, after he tells us about this, how faith responds to the trials of life, James is going to deal with how people of faith respond to truth. So in the first two sermons, how faith responds to trials, and now today, how people of faith respond to truth. And in James chapter 1, starting in verse 19, if you will all stand as we read God's word, please. Verses 19 through 25, this is what we read. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness that God requires. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. You may be seated. I want to read to you a quote from Albert Barnes, who did a commentary on the New Testament called Barnes' Notes on the New Testament. I want to read to you a quote. He says this, "Since God is the only source of good, since he tempts no man, And since by his mere sovereign goodness, without any claim on our part, we have had the high honor conferred on us of being made the first fruits of his creatures, all the things that we studied in the previous messages, we ought to be ready to hear his voice, to subdue all our evil passions, and to bring our souls to entire practical obedience. The necessity of obedience, or the doctrine that the gospel is not only to be learned, but practiced, is pursued at length in this and the following chapter of James. The particular statement here is that religion requires us to be meek and docile, to lay aside all irritability against the truth, and all pride of opinion, and all corruption of heart, and to receive meekly the engrafted word. Let's pray. Our Father, as we open up your word now and discover how we are to be doers, not just hearers, take away any rebellious spirit that we have against your truth that doesn't conform to our choices of life. And instead, by the power of your Holy Spirit, transform our choices to match your word so that we may be doers and not hearers only. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to point out to you a few things. There are notes in your connector that you can take notes if you want. We're going to kind of rapidly move through this morning, but there is a great depth in the body of this scripture that we need to try to draw out, at least to stimulate your appetites to study it more. And the first thing I want to deal with is what James deals with here when he says, "Know this, my beloved brothers," and then he tells us how we are supposed to hear the word of God, the sincerity with which we receive the word. The sincerity with which we receive the word. In other words, in verse 21, James says, "Receive the word with meekness." Receive it with meekness. And that is contrasted with putting away anger and all the things that we get mad at when the Bible tells us something that we don't necessarily want to hear, because it doesn't match our lifestyle choices, it doesn't match what we have previously been taught, it doesn't match our personalities in some way, and we get angry that God has said that. And yet James says there is a sincerity with which we are to hear and receive the word of God. In other words, we are, James says here, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. He says we are to be more inclined to hear God's word than we are to speak it. We are to be more inclined to learn than we are to teach. And if we do that well, we become teachers who teach not from a position of pride, but a position of meekness and humility, if we are first more inclined to hear. You have all had discussions and conversations with people who have more of an inclination to speak than they do to listen. They can't wait for you to be done so they can tell you their side of the story, or they can tell you a misdirected story or a misinterpretation of your story, and all they do is, "Are you done? I got something to say." Or are we more inclined to listen? You see, the ears are always open, ever ready to give instruction. To receive, I'm sorry, let me start over. I blew that. The ears are always open, ever ready to receive instruction. But the tongue is surrounded with a double row of teeth to hedge it in and to keep it within proper bounds. Be more inclined to listen than you are to speak. But how we listen is important. The scripture and the text tell us that we are to hear the truth calmly, with an open mind, and not be angry against it. Let us be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Because you see, if we immediately build a wall of defense against what God is telling us, we will respond to that truth with either rebellion or at least with quiet withdrawal from the person telling it to us. I dare say that this is true of all of us in this congregation today and out there in the world, wherever you're listening, that there have been times when the truth has been revealed to you of God's word that has completely been the opposite of what you would like to choose for your life right now. You're choosing to have sex with people that aren't your husband or wife. And you may even be choosing to have sex with people who are the same gender as you. And you hear the truth of God's word, and you immediately build a wall of defense and say, no, that is for my pleasure. I get to run my life. I get to do what I want. And I'm angry that God even said that. And then we even publicly go out and proclaim that there can't be a God that would have those kinds of limitations on moral conduct. And we argue with him, and we get angry with him. And James says, no. I want you to hear the truth with pure hearts, open minds. And in order to do that, there must be a continual putting away of all filthiness and the rampant wickedness in which we live. If we have made the decision that we're right about how we live and what we know, then it doesn't matter who tells us any other thing that may or may not be truth, we will not believe them, and we will build those foxholes of defense and lob grenades from inside them to try to destroy that person who is proclaiming to us that truth that impinges upon my freedoms. And it is only if we will confess the sins and the filthiness and admit with an open mind that we are not right about all things, that we will become hearers of the word first. The specific sin that James mentions here, because he says, put away all filthiness, that's a general term for all sin, but then he says, and rampant wickedness. Why would he say all filthiness, all sin, and then try to define it even deeper with one specific thing? Rampant wickedness. What is he referring to? If you go back and study the original Greek language here, you will discover that that rampant wickedness means this in the Greek language. It means malice towards another person. Malice towards another person. Dr. Marvin Vincent, in his Greek studies of the English language, says this: malice is an adequate translation of the word here, the word denoting a malevolent disposition towards one's neighbor. It is not a general term for moral evil, but a special form of vice. In other words, you cannot be a hearer of God's word if at the same time you are choosing to think, do, or even manage somebody else's life to think evil about another person. If you're spreading gossip that is designed to reduce and diminish one person's opinion of another, you are guilty of rampant wickedness, and you cannot be a hearer of God's word. Specific sin pointed out here, and I think James had a purpose for it, because he knows that our tendency in the flesh is to do exactly that. But Pastor, you don't know how they hurt me. You don't know the circumstances of what they did to me. I don't have to. I don't have to know, because we have a blanket statement right here that says your only response to that is grace and mercy, and to put aside all other activity that would lash out at another person, or you cannot hear the word of God. We are to receive the word of God with meekness, not with pride. The gentle attitude that is required to hear the truth. And we will receive the word with gentleness when we recognize that God has personally implanted that word into us. We do not receive the word because we're qualified to receive the word of our own qualifications. We receive the word only because, as an incredible gift, God has given us his word and implanted it in us. Remember our sermon series we did at Christmas time? I have to move. God gave us at the Christmas time. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us and dwells now by the power of God through the saving grace of Jesus Christ. He dwells in us. The Word has been implanted in us so that we can understand Him and hear Him and listen to Him. But James says, don't take for granted that you have the word. Because if you don't have the meekness of spirit that is required to receive that word, you will be only a hearer and a pretty poor one at that. But it will never have its effect on our souls. Well, I'm going to skip down a little bit, James Allen, and go to point two on your notes. And James tells us that not only is there a way that we are supposed to hear the word, but then there is a significance to remembering the word of God. The significance of remembering the word. If you read verses 22 through 25 as a total context, you would come to this conclusion that is brought out to us in verses 24 and 25, where it says, "For he who looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts." Put those two things together, you come to the conclusion that what James is saying is this: it is significant for us to remember what we have looked at. Now, some of us have... Okay, I won't include you in this. I have a face worth forgetting. Some of you feel that way about yourself, don't you? Maybe you go and look in the mirror and you walk away going, "I don't want to see any more of that." You walk away with an intention to forget what you were doing. But James is saying here that even in a normal lifestyle, you go to the mirror, you do your hair, touch up your makeup, make sure your teeth are clean, and you walk away, and you bump into somebody at the store, and you go, "I wonder if I still look okay," because you cannot remember what you saw. You don't know. The language here that James uses is that the reason that we don't remember is this: because we have not looked intently at it so as to absorb it. When James says, "But the one who looks into the perfect law and perseveres," the Greek language there means that you have looked into it so closely and intently that you have absorbed it. Now, there's a motivation for doing that. We will always look into and absorb that which we want to look at and absorb. So let me give you an illustration. Do you know who this is? Where's the pictures? Totally messed. Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay? Who's that? Aaron Rodgers. Why do you know that? Because you have looked intently at him, closely enough that you want to remember him. You like him for some reason.
I like him.
I know you do. Who's that? Anybody know who that is? Can you see him? Who's that? Nobody knows? He's also a quarterback in the National Football League. His name is Cody Kessler. He's the quarterback of the Cleveland Browns. Who cares? Who cares? You don't have any desire to look intently at his picture and to memorize it and remember it because you're so thrilled to follow Cody Kessler and the Cleveland Browns. Sorry, there's probably Cleveland people over here from Moody who are Brown. No? No? Okay. All right. That's exactly what James is saying here about the Word of God. Some of you just peruse it. Eh, that's an interesting verse. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Great. I can go out and do whatever I want, and Christ will strengthen me to do it. That has nothing to do with that verse. Nothing to do with that verse. Don't misapply Scripture, please. That has nothing to do with that. But that's how you look at Scripture. For personal benefit, make sure I look good, got on my religious clothing. Or are you looking so closely at it and intently at it because you, out of your love for God, desire to absorb Him and to know Him and then to do what it says? How do you listen? Do you listen with the desire to remember? Third, we have the seriousness of obeying the Word. The seriousness of obeying the Word. Verse 22, be doers of the Word and not hearers only. Because when you are a hearer only and don't do it, you are a deceiver of yourself. You're a deceiver of yourself. If you hear the Word of God and then compare that to all the other options you have and then make a choice on what the best option is for you, you are a deceiver of yourself. Why read the Word at all? If this is just another option for you, of all the other options that are available, if this is just another, maybe sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, do me a favor, if that's going to be your continual persevering attitude, stop reading it because it's not doing you any favors. If you have minimized the authority and the perfection of this Word as the perfect revelation of God Himself to us, if you're not going to believe that that's what it is and that it is to be obeyed at every step of what it says, and it's just another option, you are deceiving yourself. Deceiving yourself. What does that mean? The Holy Spirit of God makes it very clear here that there is no activity resulting from the Word. If there is no activity resulting from the Word of God, then there has been no true acceptance of the Word of God. Ouch. Read that again. If there is no activity resulting from hearing the Word of God, then there has been no real acceptance of the Word of God. We cannot state with any sense of integrity or confidence that we have been saved by faith in Jesus Christ if we do not obey Jesus Christ. We are deceiving ourselves if we believe that faith does not produce obedience. The Apostle John tells us that in 1 John 2. He says, whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. That seems harsh, but this is a significant issue in our lives today. Whoever keeps his word, John goes on to say, in him truly the love of God is being perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Folks, faith is not a negotiation with God. Faith is a surrender to God. Faith is not an alternative option to all of the other choices of life. Faith is a replacement to all of the other choices of life. Obedience is not a means of achieving favor with God. Obedience is the product of a heart that has been captured by God. You remember the story Jesus told of the wise and the foolish house builders? Everyone who hears these words of mine, hears the words and does them, will be like the wise man who built his house on a rock. And when the storms came, nothing happened. The house stood firm. But everyone who hears these words and does not do them is like the man who built his house on sand. And when the storms came, there was no foundation and everything fell apart. Bishop Brownrigg was quoted in one of Charles Spurgeon's sermons as saying this: to deceive is bad. To deceive yourself is worse. To deceive yourself about your soul is worst of all. And you are deceiving yourself about your soul if you say that you can believe in Him but not obey Him. If you can claim to have eternal life and the hope of glory and live only according to the hope of what this world offers, you have deceived yourself about your soul. Faith will respond with obedience. And that obedience starts with listening to the Word. And when we listen to the Word, we become willing to obey it. But willingness is not obedience. Action is obedience. Let me make this point very clear. Willingness to obey is not obedience. Simple parent-child example. Your parents have decided that they're going to pay you for chores around the house. And they sit down with you and they make up the list of the chores, and you're going to get 50 cents if you do this, and you'll get 75 cents for this, and you'll get $325,000 to go to college, and whatever it is. They've made this list, and you can earn this reward for doing this behavior. And you sit down and you wake up in the morning, and it's a Saturday morning, and you know that that's mom's routine to have you help her clean the house, get everything ready for the weekend and all the rest. And you get up and you say, "Mom, I'm really willing to help you. Thank you. I'm thankful for the rewards that will be offered. I'm thankful for the blessing I'll receive if I do it. And I bought into this system. This is a system that'll really work, and I'll get some money. And I'm really willing to do that. I'm really willing to do that." Tell me when you get to collect the money. After you've done it. You do not get allowance in advance. Parents, if you're doing that, stop. You do not get allowance in advance. There is no advance on eternal life. No advance on saving grace until you do it. Action is obedience. John 15:14, Jesus says, "You are my friends if you do what I command you." John 14:15, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." In his commentary on the book of James, David Platt shares a quote from a book that was written by three Chinese pastors. Their names are Yun, Yangzi, and Wang. Three Chinese pastors. The book is entitled Back to Jerusalem. And at the end of the book, the three pastors are talking about the difference between people who just believe in Jesus and disciples of Jesus, because there is a difference. Because disciples are doers. Believers are option seekers. And these three Chinese pastors make this distinction in David Platt's book when they say this: true disciples are usually people that few understand. They are viewed as potentially unstable fanatics. Often the same governments that tolerate the existence of mere believers will stop at no ends to completely and eradicate disciples within their borders. So I ask you, how are you surviving in America? How are you surviving? Are you surviving because you're just a believer who keeps it to yourself and fits into your culture so that you can survive and fit in? Or are you a disciple with the potential for being called a radical who may have to die for what you believe? Hearers of the word are tolerated. Doers of the word are persecuted. Which are you? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for the opportunity we've had to hear your word. We thank you for the privilege we have now to make a commitment to your word, to be doers of the word and not just hearers. And we pray that as the choir comes and we participate with them in a song at parts, that it will not just be a song, but that it will truly be the desire of our heart to be a hearer and a doer of the word as we surrender all.
Corral is going to sing, oh wow, is All to Jesus I Surrender. The first verse is going to be sung by me. The second verse, the entire choir will sing. And then we'd love for you to stand and sing with us for the third and fourth verse. Thank you.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender.
All to Jesus. Thank you all for being here today. I have a few closing statements. The first one, I'm going to address them personally, so I'm going to turn my back on you because I have a thank you for them. But my name's Pastor Josh. I'm the Family Life and Discipleship Pastor here. Thank you for being here today and celebrating and worshiping Almighty God in maybe a little different way, and this is where my thank you comes in. I want to thank you guys because as the verse from James that we studied today, it said, be slow to speak and quick to listen. And with you guys being here this morning, even sometimes worship, when we come on a Sunday morning and we sing, we don't really think about the words that we're saying. You gave us all, and myself, an opportunity to be quick to listen to those words, slow to speak, and then when we had the opportunity to speak, the first thing we said was, I love you, Lord. Thank you for letting that sink in. Thank you for letting those four words be so powerful and meaningful. And I fear that if we would have come here normally on a Sunday and just dove right into the words of singing, it wouldn't have been as meaningful. So thank you for blessing us, and thank you for blessing me and illustrating that verse so perfectly. So thank you very much. Later on in the verse, it said, be doers of the word, and Pastor John went through what that looks like. And part of being doers of the word and obeying God's word is listening, even when it comes to things like saying, give of our resources. At this moment, I'd like the ushers to come forward, and I hope that you have a little bit different perspective on giving this morning, because we're not just doing it because, hey, we need to keep the lights on here. We do need to do that. But we're doing it for opportunities like this to spread the gospel worldwide. That's what these resources are going for. And part of being faithful followers of Christ is being obedient to his word. His word tells us to be generous. It tells us to give. And so I hope this morning that you would give your normal tithes and offerings, but you'd also take that envelope out. And you would demonstrate to the Moody Chorale the generosity of God by giving his son Jesus. And by doing that, by giving and filling that envelope and giving it to them, they are going to use that wisely. They're not just pocketing that money. They're using it for more opportunities to spread the gospel. So would you please bow your heads in prayer? Father, I just thank you for this moment. I thank you for this opportunity to reflect on how awesome you are, God. To be able to cry out to you that we love you, Lord, and that we surrender all to you. Lord, I hope that that can be a true statement in my life, that I'm not just saying that in a few compartments of my life, but that totally, fully, I surrender all to you. Lord, you have what's best in mind. You have the perfect ways to glorify you, and I want to be part of that. Thank you for the opportunity that you have given each one of us to be a part of your wonderful plan of bringing you glory. We do that right now by giving. Thank you for the opportunity to give. Thank you that we all have something to give, no matter how big or small. But I thank you for the hearts of the people here this morning that are going to give freely. We trust that those in charge of these resources will use it wisely, will use it to glorify you, and for no other purpose. Thank you, Lord, for your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. As the ushers are receiving the offering, I just have a few announcements before the Moody Chorale blesses us with one final song of benediction. But last week I announced that there were going to be babies coming here at Calvary, and guess what? We had one born. So, to the Amoah family, yes, I believe this was Friday, we have Abigail Jane, and so be thankful for this great addition to the Calvary family and to the Amoah family, but next week we'll start the baby baskets. You'll notice the chest that's back there will have a baby basket open, and you can bring diapers, wipes, all that kind of stuff to bless this family with a new birth. Also coming up, there is something called Golden Apples. What I need to do real quick is if any of you ladies have graduated from our Golden Apples program, I need you to stand up. Just do it real quick. I need you to stand up. Look at all of the ladies. Yep, you may be seated. Those are just the ladies that have been part of this program. That benefits way more than just the ladies. It benefits households. It benefits fathers and their spouses. It benefits greatly into their community. That Golden Apples program is coming up. It is a women's mentoring ministry here at Golden Apples, and I'm going to read very quickly what this says. The primary purpose of Apples is for older women to nurture younger women in the Word of God, the Bible, and encourage them to obey that Word. The secondary purpose of the program is the practical application of these principles: cooking skills, homemaking skills, relational skills, manners, and hospitality. That is starting up here Thursday, February 2nd. If you are interested in more information, please see me and I'll direct you to the right people. Also, coming up this weekend is the W3 conference. That is our Levi team, the ones that are up here doing worship and that are doing the technical side of things. That workshop is coming up starting on Friday and Saturday. If you are part of that team or if you're interested in being part of that team, please be here at 6:30. Also coming up is our Jubilee Celebration Sunday. For those of you that don't know what that is, normally churches have a business meeting once a year, an annual meeting. We have the elder form of government, and so we don't have that need for that annual meeting. We choose to have a Celebration Sunday every year and look at what the Lord has done, and we celebrate and join with Him in what He's going to continue to do. That is coming up at the end of this month, Sunday, January 29th. It starts with a free breakfast. You're all invited. The elders will serve you breakfast starting at 8 o'clock, so make sure you are here for that. We're excited. Also, one last note. February 24th and 25th is called the Weekend to Remember. Focus on the Family hosts this, and they have it in different places across the nation. We have a small group of people that have decided that they're going, and they want some friends to go with them. And so if you are interested in kind of more information on that, they have a great website. I can refer you there as well. But it would be awesome to have a group of committed couples that say, I need a little rest and time out for my busy life to reconnect with my spouse. This is a great chance to do that. They're not sold out. They even have a deal going right now. So if you want more information, let me know. Before I turn it back over to the Moody Corral, I'd just like to say a final prayer for this wonderful day and how the Lord has moved. Father, once again, we come before you. Sometimes we don't get the chance to be quiet and be still. That's our own fault. Lord, I thank you for the refreshment that I've received this morning of being quiet. Not a trait I do well. Father, thank you for how you have blessed me. Thank you for the Moody Corral. I pray that each one of them was blessed by being here, that as they stand as committed followers to you, they are proclaiming your praises. They are worshiping Almighty God through their songs and through their talents. And I thank you for the hard work that they put in, and their dedication has proved itself this morning. I just thank you for this opportunity. I thank you that as they go to different locations, that they are seeking your face and that they are following exactly what you want them to do to bring you glory. I pray that each one of us would do the same, that as we leave here this morning, we would be committed to living and loving just like Jesus did. We pray all of these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. In closing, we would like to sing two more songs for you. The first one talks about keeping your lamps trimmed and burning, for the time is drawing nigh, and to the hope that we have in heaven. And the second one is a choral benediction. It says, "The Lord bless you and keep you."
I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so, somehow, to attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do: forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus.
To the faithful, you show yourself faithful. And to the blameless, you show yourself blameless. To the pure, you show yourself pure. But to the devious, you show yourself shrewd. You, my Lord, keep my lamp burning, for my God turns my darkness into light.
Thank you all for coming, and I trust you'll stop by the table, thank them personally, and find out more information on Moody and the Moody Chorale. Have a great week.